discuss about sequential circuits. Up to now we have seen combinational circuits whose outputs depends only on the present inputs, and those are the circuits which are mainly used in those applications where memory elements are not required. But when it comes to sequential circuits, these circuits are mainly used in those applications where memory elements are required. Okay, and they are used in most of the digital devices, and the outputs of these particular circuits will not only depends on the present inputs but also depends on the past outputs. So let us see how to design the sequential circuits and where we use these sequential circuits. So most digital systems like watches, phones, computers, traffic light controllers, so every digital device would be using these sequential circuits which uses memory elements, and these memory elements are used for storing information in the form of ones and zeros. Okay, the output of the system with memory depends not only on the present inputs but also on what has happened in the past. So as just now I said, so these circuit the output of these circuits will not only depends on the present inputs but also depends on the past outputs or past inputs. So most of the digital systems are designed with combination circuits along with memory elements. So all of these systems are designed with combinational circuits along with some memory elements. So these memory elements are used for storing the binary information. Okay, now let us see the block diagram of this sequential circuits, and this is the block diagram of the sequential circuit where it is designed with the help of combinational circuit and a memory element. Okay, as you can see here, the output of this combinational circuit is given as an input to the memory element, and the output of this memory element is given as a feedback input to the combinational circuit. Now the output of this particular combinational circuit not only depends on the present inputs but also depends on this past output which are coming from the memory element output. Okay, and these memory elements are called as flip-flops. So we would be using memory elements, that is flip-flops, in sequential circuits. Okay, now let us see what are those memory elements. So memory elements are of two types, mainly they are latches and flip-flops. Okay, so both of these are used for storing the information, that is one bit of information, and both are similar, but the only difference is the latches, their outputs are constantly affected by their inputs as long as the enable signal is asserted. So here if latch is enabled, then the latch is going to process the input and produces the output. So as the latches are enabled continuously, therefore any change in the output, sorry, any change in the input would be resulting a change in the output. So continuously a change would be occurred at the output accordingly to the input changes. But when it comes to flip-flops, their content change only either at the rising or falling edge of the enable signal. As you can see here, only the rising edge and falling edge would cause a change at the output. Okay, so here the flip-flop is going to process the inputs only during the rising or falling edge of the enable signal, and this signal is usually the control clock signal. After the rising or falling edge of the clock, the flip-flop content remains constant even if the input changes. Okay, so after rising or falling edge of the clock signal, then even if you change the input, then the output of the flip-flop will not be changed. They maintains a constant output. Okay, so all these latches and flip-flops are designed with the help of universal gates, that is NAND and NOR. So all the flip-flops as well as the latches are designed with the help of universal gates, that is NAND and NOR. So let us see the types of these latches and flip-flops. There are mainly four types: SR, D, JK and T. Okay, so we'll discuss each and every one in detail. So initially we'll start our discussion with SR latch. As you can see, this is the circuit of the SR latch, okay, where two NOR gates are used here, and the Q output of the NOR gate is connected as a feedback input to the second NOR gate, and the Q bar output of this NOR gate is connected as a feedback input to the first NOR gate. Okay, and the output of the first NOR gate is Q, and the output of the second NOR gate is Q bar, which is nothing but complement of Q. And this is the graphical symbol which we use for representing this SR latch, and this is the functional table or truth table, we can also call it as truth table, where it gives the combinations of where it gives the relation between the input and the output. As you can see here, at the output Qn and Qn plus 1, Qn is nothing but present state or current state output, and Qn plus 1 is nothing but next state or future time output. Okay, so let us see, analyze this circuit with the help of this functional tip. Okay, so initially we'll substitute 00, 01, 10 and 11. Okay, so if you are substituting 00, then it means the output of the circuit would be remains constant. Qn is nothing but the present state. Okay, if you are applying 01, then the output is 1. If you are applying 10, then the output is 0. If you are applying 11, this particular state is called as a indeterminate state. Okay, so let us analyze this particular circuit with the help of these possible combinations. So assuming that previously we have used this particular SR latch, now Q is holding 1, so as Q is holding 1, therefore Q bar would become 0, and assuming that R and S are at 0 positions, or initially they are inactive. Okay, now let us assume that now this R input is applied with logic 1. So what happens if we apply logic 1 to the R input? Okay, now as we know, what is this NOR gate? What is the output of the NOR gate? So the output of the NOR gate would be 0 if one of the input is 1. Okay, and the output of the NOR gate is 1 only if when both the inputs are zeros. Okay, so let us see that. So when R goes active 1, the output from the first gate must be 0. Okay, so as the input to the first OR gate is 1, as I told you that if one of the input to the NOR gate is 1, then the output would become 0. Okay, therefore now the output is 0. Now as one of the input to the second NOR gate is 0, now it would be waiting for the other input. Now that input would be coming from the Q. Now as Q is 0, S is 0, then the output becomes 1. Okay, so since both inputs are 0, the output is forced to 1, as just now I said. Now this particular output would be constant. Why? Because 0 is applied here and 1 is applied here, therefore you will be getting 0 and 1 continuously. Okay, and this particular state is called as reset state. Okay, now now if I apply a 0 at the reset input, okay, now S input is 0, now what happens? Okay, as Q input is 0, now as S is 0, Q is 0, then the output would become 1, and this output is given as an input to R, therefore again the output is 0. Now whenever this R and S are 0, then the output would not be changed. It would be staying, or it would be holding the present state output. Okay, as you can see here, we have started from this point, that is R equals 0, and now we are at R equals to 1. Now here you can see there is a change in the output. Initially it was Qn, now it was changed to 0. Okay, so in that process Q changed from 1 to 0, further signals on R will have no effect. Okay, now we'll move with one more condition, that when R and S are activated, it means if both are applied with logic 1 simultaneously, both outputs will go to a 0. Why? Because as I told you that if the OR gate, if one of the input to the OR gate is 1, then the output would be 0. Okay, as both the OR gates are receiving one of the input as 1, then the outputs of both these OR gates are zeros. Okay, and this is not possible. Why? Because if the output of the Q is 0, then you have to get Q bar as a complement of Q, but you are getting logic 0, and this particular state is called as a metastable state, or else a indeterminate state. Okay, so here you can see the truth table again. 00, if you are giving 00, then the circuit would be holding the present state output, and if you are giving 01, then the output is 1. Okay, and this particular state is called as a set. If you are applying 10, then it is called reset. So, and if you are applying 11, then it is a undetermined or indefinite state. Now let us see the same SR latch with the help of NAND gates. Okay, as we have seen just now the SR latch with the help of NOR gates, now we'll see the SR latch with the help of NAND gates with inverted inputs. As you can see that R bar and S bar, R is reset and S is set. Okay, and this is the graphical symbol, and this is the functional table. Okay, so we can again analyze this circuit with the help of this functional table in the same way as we have analyzed the NOR gate implementation. Okay, so this is what the application of SR latch, where you can see that there are two SR latches which are connected to two buttons. Okay, and this kind of system is implemented in the hospital, where bed 1 is connected with one button and bed 2 is connected with the other button, and there is a master reset. Okay, for example, assume that if this particular switch is closed, then S would be receiving a logic high, therefore the output of the Q would become 1. okay, and here the output of Q is 0, therefore 1 0 is nothing but a warning bell. The output of this OR gate is 1, and there is a bed light which is connected to, or a light which is connected to this bed 2, and that will be turned on. So this is how we can use the latches in most of the applications. Okay, now let us see a clocked SR latch. Up to now we have seen SR latch which will produce the output at any point of time. As you change the input, then the output will be changed. But I want to control the output only during certain situations or certain points. I want the flip-flop to process the inputs only during a certain situations. Okay, so in those cases I would be going with one control input. Okay, and this is of the circuit we can design with the help of a control input. This is the basic SR latch which is connected with two AND gates, and these AND gates are receiving R and S input along with the clock input or as the control input. Okay, so when C equals 0, as C equal to 0, okay, so if one of the input to the AND gate is 0, then the output would become 0. Okay, assuming that if Q equal to 0, then if 0 0 is the input of the second NOR gate, then the output would become 1, and this 1 would be given as an input to this first NOR gate, then the output will become 0. Okay, so here it would be maintaining the same state. Okay, if C is 0, and if C is 1, then what happens? This circuit will be performing similar operation as just now we have seen with the help of this NOR gate implementation. Okay, so this is the graphical symbol of the clocked SR latch, and this is the functional table where you can see if clock input is 0 or control input is 0, okay, then the output will not be depending on the, so whatever might be the input, then the output would be holding the same state, that is QN, present state. Okay, and if this clock input is 1, then the output would be varying according to the input SR. Okay, if input SR is 0 0, then the output would be holding the present state. Okay, and if input SR is 1 0, then the output is 1, and if input is 0 1, then the output is 0, and if input is 1 1, as just now we have seen that it is a unused state or else it is a indeterminate state. As this state is unknown to us, we should not use this particular state whenever we are using this particular SR latch in any kind of application. Okay, now let us see one more latch, that is D latch. And the main advantage of using D latch is it removes the undefined behavior of the SR latch. Okay, and it is designed with the help of the same SR latch where the D input is tied to S as well as is connected to S, and the inverting input of the D is connected to R. Okay, and this is what the truth table that we get. If clock input is 0 or control input is 0, then the output would be holding the same state as it is similar to the SR latch. But if this clock input is 1, okay, and if D input is 0, then the output would be reset. That is nothing but 0. If clock input is 1, if D input is 1, then the output is set state. Okay, and this latch is also known as a data latch or as a delay latch. Okay, now let us see the same D latch with the help of a clock which is nothing but a control input. Okay, so here same SR latch which is connected with two AND gates along with whose input is S, R as well as C, and then now D input is directly given to S, and inverted D input is given to R. It means that both active 1 inputs at S and R can't occur. Okay, so this is how we are going to overcome the drawback which is present in case of SR latch. And you can see the timing diagram here. Okay, so by seeing this, okay, you can easily know when this particular Q will be changed according to the input. Okay, so if here clock input is high and D input is high, then only the output would be varying. Okay, and if clock input is low, okay, and the Q would be maintaining the same state, and if clock input is high again, then according to the D input, the output would be varying. Okay, as the clock input is high here and D input is 0, therefore the output again, yes, output would be changed to 0. Okay, so this is how the output would be following the D input based on the clock. Now let us see one more flip-flop which is nothing but a JK flip-flop, and it is again mainly used for overcoming the drawback which is present in SR flip-flop. When J and K both equals 1, the output toggles on the active clock edge. So when S and R are 1, then it is an indeterminate state, and if J and K are 1, then the output would be toggling. It means if the output is 1, then if JK is 1, then the output would be toggled, which is nothing but changing from 1 to 0. Okay, and this is again designed with the help of SR flip-flop. As you can see, the functional table where the output would be same for all these three combinations, but it would be different for only the one combination, that is 1-1. Okay, now the output is Qn bar, which is nothing but toggling of the present state. Okay, now this is how we can design the circuit of JK flip-flop. Okay, as you can see that one SR latch, which whose inputs are connected to the outputs of the NAND gates. Okay, and the inputs of these NAND gates are J, and this NAND gate is K, and one clock input along with the Q bar output is connected to J, and Q output is connected to K. Okay, initially assume that Q is 0 and Q bar is 1. Okay, and then apply all these combinations. Okay, let us go with one of the combination, that is 0 and 0. Okay, and clock input is high. So here clock input is high, and then J and K are 0, as we have assumed that Q is 0. So Q is 0, which is applied over here, and Q bar will be applied to this particular A gate. Okay, now the output of these two NAND gates would be logic 1. Why? Because logic 1. Why? Because if one of the input to these NAND gates is 0, then the output would definitely become 1. Okay, now as one of the input of the NAND gate is 1 here, now okay, and one of the input of this NAND gate is 1, now here this particular Q bar is connected over here. Q bar is 1, therefore 1 and 1 to the input of this particular NAND gate would be producing the output as 0, and this is initially 0. Now this 0 and 1 to the input of the NAND gate would be producing a logic 1. Okay, so initially we have started with Q0 and Q bar 1, and we have got the same output, which is nothing but it would be holding the same state, that is Qn. Clear? Okay, so this is how we are going to overcome the drawback which is present in SR latch or SR flip flop. Okay, now this is the timing diagram where you can see how the output is going to be changed according to the input based on the clock signal. Okay, so here it is toggled, here it is a hold state, which is nothing but maintaining the same or constant state, and this is the reset state, and this is the set state. Now this is how we can design a JK flip-flop with the help of a D flip-flop. Okay, so D flip-flop, and the input to the D flip-flop is coming from J and K, okay, which are going through AND gates and OR gate. Okay, and now let us see what is the drawback which is present in this JK flip-flop. The JK flip-flop seems to solve all the problems associated with both inputs at one. Okay, just now we have seen, however, the clock rise or fall is of finite duration. As we know that clock rising as well as the falling duration would be of a finite one. If clock pulse takes long enough, the circuit can toggle and causes race around condition. Okay, if at all the clock duration is very much high, therefore it introduces a problem, that is race around condition. Okay, and this produces uncertain output, and it can be avoided by using master slave flip-flop. Okay, so if this race around condition is produced, then the output would be uncertain. It means the output would be changing from 1 to 0, 0 to 1 continuously. So we cannot predict the output of a particular input. Okay, even though you are not changing the input J and K, then the output would be varying from 1 to 0 and 0 to 1. Okay, and that particular situation or condition is called as a race around condition, and that can be overcome with the help of master slave flip-flop. It means you have to connect two JK flip-flops in cascaded manner. Okay, then it will avoid this particular race around condition. Okay, now let us see the last flip-flop, that is toggle flip-flop. It is also known as T flip-flop. Okay, is a complementing flip-flop and can be obtained from a JK flip-flop when inputs J and K are tied together. Okay, and this is again designed with the help of JK flip-flop. Okay, if the inputs J and K are tied together, then it becomes a toggle flip-flop. Okay, if this T is 0, if you are applying T is as 0, then 0 0 is the input to the J and K. As we know that if J and K are receiving zeros at the input, then the output Q would be at the no change, which is nothing but a hold state. Okay, same present state would be continuing. Okay, if you are applying 1, then J and K are applied with logic 1s, therefore the output would Q would become complement of the present state. Okay, so that is why it is called as a toggle flip-flop. Now here you can see how actually this toggle flip-flop is obtained. Okay, the output Q is connected to the D through one XOR gate along with T. Okay, and this is the graphical symbol just now we have seen, and this is the characteristic equation of this particular T flip-flop. Okay, this is obtained just by plotting the truth table or functional table of this T flip-flop on the K map, and these are the characteristic equations of all the flip-flops D, T, SR and JK, and we are going to obtain all these characteristic equations by just plotting the truth tables or functional tables on the K map. Okay, and we have to reduce it. So these are all the characteristic equations of all the flip-flops. Now let us see what is this edge triggering and level triggering or level sensitive. Okay, so edge triggered flip-flops transition output change can happen only during the clock pulse transition. So output of the flip-flop would only be changed when there is a transition of the clock pulse. Okay, and that transition in the clock pulse, it might be a positive clock or else a negative clock transition. So here flip-flop is going to process the input and produces the output only during the positive clock transition or else the negative clock transition. But when it comes to level sensitive or level triggering flip-flop, as long as the pulse level is up or down, output can change. Okay, so as long as the clock signal is holding a logic high or else a logic low, okay, then the output is going to change accordingly with the input. Okay, and here level sensitive clock is less favorite because depending on the duration of the pulse, output may change a number of times. Okay, so if at all the clock pulse is high for a duration called as X, then the output would be changing for the same duration according to the input. Okay, so that is why level sensitive flip-flops are rarely used. Now here you can see the positive level. Okay, this is what called as a positive level. Okay, during this level, whatever the input is there, that would be processed and it produces the output. But when it comes to positive and negative edge, as you can see, only during this particular edge or this particular edge, the flip-flop is going to process the input and produces the output. Positive edge, negative as well as this negative edge. Okay. Now here you can see the graphical symbols where we are representing the positive edge as well as the negative edge. So if you are indicating this clock with an arrow, then it is nothing but a positive edge. If you are using an inverted arrow or inverting clock input as arrow, then it represents the negative edge flip-flop. Here you can see the timing diagram where initially this particular Q output is unknown. Okay, now here the clock has one positive edge. Here it is a positive edge triggered flip-flop. Okay, now this clock is having one positive edge. Now the input is zero, therefore the output would be zero. Okay, and now this zero is maintained until one more positive edge is appeared on the clock. So as there is a one positive edge on the clock, okay, then it would check for the input. Now again the input is zero, therefore the zero is again maintained until one more positive edge appears on the clock. Now here there is a positive edge on the clock. As the input has now changed to 1, therefore the output now become 1 again. As you can see here, when the clock has a high level or low level, okay, the output of the input at D is 1, but even though the output is constantly holding the same or present state. Okay, so this is how we can control the operation of a flip-flop with the help of this clock input. Now here you can see the master slave D flip-flop. Okay, so the output is connected to the input of the next flip-flop, and a clock is connected with an inverted through an inverter. Okay, now here if you are applying the positive clock or else the positive pulse, okay, then this particular master would be processing the inputs, and and during that time, now it is receiving the negative pulse. Okay, so it is receiving the negative pulse, therefore it would be in a idle state. Okay, now as when you apply the negative pulse, then this would be in an idle state. Now the output of this master would be processed by the slave. Why? Because now it is receiving the positive pulse. Okay, so here at a time both the master as well as the slave will not be working. Okay, so here you can see the same diagram with the help of the logic gates. So no matter how long the clock pulse, both circuits cannot be active at the same time. Why? Because we are giving the clock input to the slave through a inverter. Okay, now let's see what we have discussed up to now. Two cross coupled NOR gates form an SR latch. Okay, and a clocked SR latch has an additional input that controls when setting and resetting can take place. Okay, a D latch has a single data input. The output is held when the clock input is a zero. The input is copied to the output when the clock input is a one. As just now we have discussed, the D latch is going to process the input only when the clock input is one. Okay, and the output of the clocked D latch can be represented by the following behavior. As you can see here, if clock input or control input is 1, then the input is directly copied as the output. Clocked latches are level triggered. While the clock is high, inputs and thus outputs can change. Okay, and a flip-flop is edge triggered either by the leading or falling edge of the clock pulse. So as just now we have discussed, flip-flop as well as latch both are same, but the only difference is here we are giving a control input, but here we are giving a clock input. Clock would be changing continuously, but whereas the control input would be constant for a particular duration. Okay, ideally it responds to the inputs only at a particular instant in time. Okay, flip-flops would respond to the inputs only during a particular instant of time. Thank you.